Academic Committee of the Center for the Study of Christianity. Welcome to you all. I am honored to open this prestigious conference here at the Hebrew University of Jerusalem, 44 years after its establishment in 1973, and almost 20 years after the establishment of the Center for the Study of Christianity by Gis Frunza and Menachem Ben Sasson, at that period director of the Hebrew University. It is a great privilege for the Center and the Hebrew University to host this impressive gathering of scholars from afar about 20 different countries and from Israel itself. The president, director, and the dean of the faculty send their apologies. They are unable to join us tonight due to a last-moment change in their schedule. They extended their best wishes for a successful conference, and the president will join us tomorrow at 10 o'clock. Recently, a friend asked what makes me enthusiastic about the Origeniana. My answer was the following, and I have three answers. First, the topic. The topic of this Origeniana, Origen's Legacy in the Holy Land, a tale of three cities, Jerusalem, Caesarea, and Bethlehem. Although the study of Origen has been steadily gaining scholarly attention, his legacy in the Holy Land awaits further study. It is especially intriguing to discuss this subject in light of the new discovery from 2012 of Origen's homilies on the Psalm. Quite enigmatic for me is the topic of Origen's perception of the Holy Land, if indeed he has one, and the ways he configured his view on this corner of the world, Palestine, in which he dwelt for about 20 decades at the end of his life. I hope that this conference will fill the gap in Robert Wilkins' important study, The Land Called Holy. The second reason why I am enthusiastic about this gathering is the people. We are all pleased by the presence of many leading scholars who shape not only the field of Origen research, but those of ancient Christianity and late antiquity as well. The most senior among them tonight is Professor Angelo Di Berardino, a well-known figure to all students and scholars of patristic studies. Where are you? I'm really very touched by your presence. It is a great pleasure to open the 12th Origeniana in the presence of Professor Anders Christian Jacobson from Aarhus University in Denmark, who organized in 2013 the 11th Origeniana. I wish to thank him for publishing the proceedings so quickly and with such care. Thank you, Anders. I am delighted that about 25% of the papers in this conference will be delivered by young scholars, PhD and postdoctoral students. Clearly, we are witnessing a thriving stage and a solid continuation in the study of ancient Christianity. Their research, in fact, is well grounded in the classic philological tradition and method, distinguishing it from new scholarly trends which tend to ignore texts and their historical context, yet pretend to provide historical insights. We are proud to belong to the old school, especially when our master, our Origen, and his indirect disciples, Eusebius, Jerome, and Rufinus, who will be discussed by insightful experts at our conference. We arrive at the third source of my enthusiasm. Despite the fact that some of the finest origin scholars are women, for example, Marguerite Arl, very well known, this is the first Originiana organized by a woman. It is my hope. It is my hope that it will not be the last. Nonetheless, I am far from alone in fulfilling this heavy task. I shall mention two men whom stand at my side. The first is my husband, Ilan. Who has long shared with me the faculty's frustrations, the department's dilemma, and the joy of the center. Thank you, Ilan. Second, I thank my fabulous assistant and secretary of the center, Daniel Shalem. We are all indebted to you for your professional work and intelligent contribution to the conference. Some here may not be aware that Daniel does double duty. While seriously working his doctoral dissertation, for the past 5 years, he has fulfilled in exemplary fashion the task of administration in the center. Thank you for your kindness and dedication to the center's goal, and especially for dealing so cheerfully with the inevitable problems that pop up. Thanks. I also wish to extend my gratitude to Abir, who helped enormously this week, to the fellows of the center, and to Merav Yaakobi, all of whom contributed in one way or another to the conference. Thanks in advance to Helen Newman and Yossi Patri, who will guide us in Caesarea. This is a good opportunity to express my gratitude to the members of the Academic Committee of the Center for the superb suggestions and qualified support I received from them during my 7 years long tenure as director. Roni Ellenblum, the chair of the committee, Rina Telgam, Nurit Stadler, Meir Hatina, David Satran, and Oded Irshai. Thank you so much. I have also the pleasure to announce that Oded Irshai will be the next director of the center, and I wish him great success and excellent committee as I head. Last, but by no means least, we owe great to the vision and generosity of Aldegonde and Hubert Benningmeyer-Ferhan. Dear Aldegonde, I have been fortunate indeed to have had your support as well as that of Hubert and Martin. My years as director of the center were highly enhanced by your creative ideas and friendship. Over the years, you have realized the words of Origen, who wrote in his treatise on prayer, that through prayer, the impossible becomes possible. In the name of the students and my colleagues, I would like to say that through your insightful work, liaisons and sincere dialogue with the Jewish people, as well as your appreciation of many scholars in the Hebrew University, the impossible is becoming possible. Thank you. The impossible The Impossible is also the subtitle of the chef d'oeuvre of our keynote speaker tonight, Professor Lorenzo Peroni. La Priera secondo Origen, Le Impossibilità Donata. I am not going to list his publication, several books and about 400 articles. Professor Peroni, whose scholarly output is renowned, really needs no introduction among scholars of Origen, and certainly not in Jerusalem. He is almost a citizen of the Holy Land. He himself organized the Colloquium Origenianum Octavum in Pisa in 2001, and his ongoing contribution to Adamantius, which he edited for many years, enjoy international acclaim. For the benefit of the younger generation, however, I shall mention Professor Peroni's deep and long-standing relationship with the Hebrew University. In 1985, he initiated collaboration with the archaeologists in our faculty, and in 1993, he was invited by the late Professor Yoram Tzafrir to the Institute for Advanced Studies. Professor Peroni spent the years 2010 and 2015 at the Institute, continuing to inspire our academic community. Thanks to the Mandel School's visiting professorship, in 2013, he was able to work for several months in Jerusalem on the new discovery of Origen's homilies on the Psalm. In 2015, the Greek and Latin texts to this important find were published in collaboration with Antonio Cacciari and Emanuela Pancivalli. We'll have the pleasure of hearing Professor Pancivalli deliver the plenary lecture tomorrow morning. A preeminent scholar of Origen, Professor Peroni has also published a great deal on Christianity in the Holy Land. In fact, his first book, written in 1980, was devoted to La Chiesa di Palestina during the Christological controversies of the 5th century. Since then, he has been working on the monastic movement and other aspects of Christianity in late antique Palestine. Tonight, we are delighted to hear him speak on Origen's legacy in the Holy Land, fortune and misfortune of literary and theological heritage. Professor Peroni, please.
Dear Bruria, dear colleagues and friends, let me say a few words before I begin, not simply to thank the organizers of the conference, as they fully deserve, but also to highlight its importance for me in the context of the Hebrew University of Jerusalem and the scholarly community of this country. In 3 decades, since I went here for the first time, I learned to discover more and more the unique opportunities for religious studies at Hebrew University, the Israel Institute for Advanced Studies, and other academic institutions of Israel. I never met Ephraim Urbach or Sarah Kamin, who, as specialists of rabbinic Judaism, were both interested in Origen's biblical exegesis, although I know that they had an influence and many contacts with colleagues living here in Jerusalem. But I had the privilege to become acquainted with some of the leading scholars in our field: David Flusser, Zvi Verblovsky, Guy Strumsa. They contributed in different ways to search the nexus between Judaism and Christianity, without isolating both religious traditions from the study of Islam and the other world religions. The Department of Comparative Religion at the Hebrew University has been home to these studies and has further developed them through the excellent teachers and doctoral students, its many research projects, and international conferences. This impressive activity has been supported by the creation of a Center for the Study of Christianity at the Hebrew University. There is no need to stress how this initiative has proved fruitful in the course of time. After the Congress held in 2013 for the 50th anniversary of the International Association of Patristic Studies, today's achievement with this new major conference is an encouraging promise for the future. From the beginning, I also appreciated the invaluable work done in their turn by Israeli archaeologists, epigraphists, and historians of ancient art for the history of biblical, Roman, and Byzantine Palestine. My unforgettable friend, Yoram Tzafrir, fully understood the importance of the study of ancient Christianity in connection with archaeological research. I would like to dedicate my lecture to his memory. We are close to ancient Jerusalem. We know that it has no river. For the first time since its beginning in 1973, the International Origin Conference takes place in a city with which the Alexandrian was well acquainted. He pointed it out when he was preaching in Caesarea on Psalm 77 by recalling, as in the sixth book of the Commentary on John, Psalm 45:5a, "The river's strong currents make glad the city of God." However, this time he stressed the proximity of his actual location to the old capital of Israel. It would be tempting now to depict Jerusalem as Origen knew it, and to repeat for Jerusalem what John McCacken brilliantly did for Caesarea in a contribution to the Boston Conference in 1989. On that occasion, he compensated for the missing evidence in the writings of Origen by other literary sources, and especially by the archaeological materials available for the history of Roman Caesarea. So we may rely on the remains of Aelia Capitolina in the 2nd and 3rd century CE. Origen himself provides us with more information on traditions and places of contemporary Jerusalem than he did for his new residence after leaving Alexandria. He knows, for instance, a local tradition of presumably Judeo-Christian origins, according to which the burial of Adam, previously located by the Jews in the area of the temple, had been placed under the Calvary, anticipating, in a way, the situation that we still face nowadays in the complex of the Holy Sepulchre. Moreover, not only does he mention the statues of the emperors standing on the esplanade of the ruined temple, he also reports that Mount Zion was occupied by quadrupeds and pagans, while declaring that this same area, by association with Temple Mount, continued to be dear to the Jews because of the alleged divine presence there. These and other similar details of historical and topographical nature make Origen an interesting witness for archaeologists and historians, not only of pagan and early Christian Jerusalem, but also of Roman Palestine before Constantine and the shaping of a holy land for the Christians. Bearing in mind the many places that he must have visited in his journeys through the country, before he finally moved to Caesarea, we can retrace a first biblical tour through the land of the Old and the New Testament. At the very beginning of his sojourn in Palestine, when he recommenced dictating the sixth book of the Commentary on John, he stated that he had gone on the tracks of Jesus, his disciples, and the prophets. Thanks to this sort of pilgrimage, instead of reading in John 1:28, Bethany beyond the Jordan, he opted for the toponym of Betabara on the eastern shore of the river as the site where John baptized. Conforming to local reports, he was able to check personally the alternative indication thanks to an inspection of the spot. It is not my aim to take Origen as our guide through the city of Jerusalem or the land of Israel, Palestine in his time. What I would like to do, in response to the invitation of the organizers and in light of the general theme of our conference, is rather to try to understand why this region, from a historical, religious, and cultural viewpoint, became so decisive for Origen's work and legacy, for good or ill, much more than Egypt, his homeland, or other more important areas of ancient Christendom. Certainly, the familiarity of the Alexandrian with his second home and its surroundings helps us, first of all, to recognize the simple fact that Origen's coming to Palestine around 233 was far from being an accidental event, an extemporaneous way out in the midst of a critical situation, or even merely another chapter, albeit significant, in his biography. Moreover, it was in fact like a second life for him, as I will attempt to show. At the same time, it was precisely the move from Alexandria to Caesarea that essentially laid the foundations for the future survival of his literary and theological heritage. If the reception of Origen throughout history, as perhaps no other author of late antiquity, has always been marked by the contrasting picture of fortune and misfortune, it goes back first and foremost to the characteristics of the Alexandrian's legacy and the vicissitudes it originally experienced in the Holy Land. After discussing the consequences of the move to Caesarea on Origen's status and activity, particularly in regard to his contacts with the Jewish milieu, I shall deal more briefly with the destiny of his legacy in the Holy Land. The move from Alexandria to Caesarea, its consequences for Origen's status and activity. Origen's contacts with the future Holy Land most probably go back to the second decade of the 3rd century, more than 15 years before he settled in Caesarea, that is, when he was at his early 30s. Today, it is largely admitted that Notin's masterpiece on the life and writings of the Alexandrian needs a revision, among other aspects, also as far as chronology is concerned. Contrary to the temporal frame proposed by the French scholar, by going back to Eusebius' dating of Origen's first journey to Palestine in the reign of Emperor Caracalla, around 215 CE, we may detect an early network of relations that involved not only Alexander and Theoctistus, the bishops respectively of Jerusalem and Caesarea, but also the neighboring churches of Arabia. Origen visited the province on the eastern border of Palestine 3 or 4 times in order to participate in doctrinal disputes, often convened in the form of a synod, as witnessed by the dialogue with Heraclides. If we consider the Alexandrian orbit in which the churches of Palestine tendentially positioned themselves at the turn of the 3rd century CE, as attested by Eusebius' narrative of the Paschal controversy under Pope Victor, Origen's connection with the Christian communities of this region does not come as a surprise. It is even less so if we remember that Clement of Alexandria preceded him in Jerusalem, thanks to his relations with Bishop Alexander, to whom he dedicated a work entitled Ecclesiastical Canon or Against Judaizers. Thus, the fame of the school of Alexandria with its first masters, Panthenus and Clement, both deeply revered by the Jerusalem bishop, must have reached the Palestinian church quite early, even if not to the detriment of other influences, as proved also by the Cappadocian provenance of Alexander. So Origen's relation to Clement leaves some room for incertitude, inasmuch as he never mentions him. After all, we could suppose that he followed the footsteps of his predecessor in the Christian school of Alexandria, even if he preferred Caesarea to Jerusalem. I purposely insist on these premises, both historical and biographical, to better appreciate to what extent the transfer to Caesarea represents a turn in Origen's life and activity. Scholars generally agree that the two decades he spent in Palestine, apart from being for us the best known period of his life, should be regarded also as the most productive ones. To say it with the words of the great Adolf von Harnack, thanks to Origen's presence, Caesarea became a second Alexandria for the promotion of Christian scholarship. Was then Origen going on to develop his work as usually in the new home after the stormy circumstances which led him to leave the Alexandrian church in the wake of what seems a personal decision rather than under external pressure? Or was he obliged to modify his literary agenda in some way, conforming with his new milieu and its needs? According to Ronald Heine, who carefully analyzes the transition from Alexandria to Caesarea, there was certainly a change, eventually an important one, but it consisted in a gradual shift of the theological and apologetic interests due to the different religious landscape of Roman Palestine. We might nonetheless expect more thoroughgoing consequences. As we know, the Origen who came to live in Palestine was definitely a renowned theologian, whom Julia Mamea, the mother of Emperor Alexander Severus, had invited to the court in Antioch for a personal interview shortly before he arrived in Caesarea. He was nonetheless also a controversial figure for the ecclesiastical establishment of Alexandria, not only his bishop Demetrius, but also Heraclius, a former pupil and his assistant in the Alexandrian Didaskaleion, had problems with him, presumably because of his too independent and creative spirit. Moreover, the birthplace of Origen was characterized by the intense flourishing of schools, Christian and pagan, so that both he and Heraclius had enjoyed for a while the teaching of a philosopher. As a rule, his Alexandrian audience, including also heretics and philosophically interested Athens, nourished high expectations of him. On the other hand, in Alexandria, he could also rely on lifelong friends to whom he addressed one of his most interesting autobiographical letters, not to speak of his ties with Dionysius, the successor of Heraclius as the head of the Didaskaleion. Over against the complex cultural background of Alexandria, the intellectual atmosphere of Caesarea would seem at first sight to imply a condition of isolation, for the lack of a public comparable to that of the Egyptian metropolis. Was he then condemned to be a lonely Christian teacher on the stage of a provincial capital? Not at all. This was not the case, and not only as the result of some important factors connected with the new environment that we shall examine soon. Primarily, it depended upon the transformation of Origen's professional status. By now, he was not anymore essentially a teacher, albeit in the context of an ecclesiastical community as in Alexandria. In Caesarea, he acted also as a priest of the local church, while he exerted this new role eminently through his activity as preacher. In my opinion, this is the most remarkable novelty in his new stage of life. in spite of the fact that Origen never ceased to write and teach in a school. Yet finally, he became more than ever a man of the church, as he often wished himself to be qualified. This process of a stronger institutional identification did not otherwise obfuscate in him a sharp awareness of the deficiencies and evils in the churches around the middle of the third century, with regard more specifically to the priestly and episcopal hierarchy, as documented by his commentary on Matthew, the last he wrote, with its evangelical anticlericalism. Origen's admittance into the ecclesiastical ranks did not otherwise prevent him from exploiting as much he could the unique opportunities offered by the new environment of Caesarea, especially with its Jewish milieu. The foundation of Herod the Great was in the third century not simply a provincial capital, but the thriving metropolis of Roman Palestine, one of the major harbors of the Eastern Mediterranean, and a lively multicultural and multireligious center. In some respects, the religious competition in Caesarea was not so far from that of Alexandria, whereas the city presented additional challenges. Mainly inhabited by a pagan population, it was also home to a large Jewish community, as well as to a Samaritan minority. Greek, Latin, Aramaic, and Hebrew were the languages in use, either as spoken idioms or as the reference languages for public administration or for cult and study. As for the little Christian community, Caesarea was historically the place in which the primitive church opened itself for the first time to the Gentile world, thanks to the conversion of the centurion Cornelius. In spite of such a title of nobility, together with other stories reported by the Acts of the Apostles, the spread of Christianity remained relatively modest when Origen settled there. As he confesses in the first homily on Psalm 36, reflecting on the composite visage of the local church, the faithful were a rather tiny group. I quote, "We are not a folk, but few people have believed from this city and others from another city," end of quote. Nevertheless, the occasions for converting someone to Christianity did not lack, if in another sermon Origen can allude to some in the audience who were pagans just a few days before. At any rate, a Christian presence was not monolithic, but included heterodox variants, to judge from Origen's constant campaign against Gnostics, Marcionites, or Judeo-Christians. Given the multi-religious characteristics of the city, some interaction among the various groups was likely to develop, often enough polemically, but to some extent also in a dialogical, if not in a properly Irenic way. As we shall see, the new situation encouraged Origen to look for interreligious contacts that were not completely devoid of dialogue. The Alexandrian, then, far from feeling exiled in Caesarea and nostalgically longing for his lost homeland that he never visited again, preferring to hit other destinations, seems to have taken advantage of the Palestinian capital as a political observatory, as proven last but not least by the against Celsus. He knew quite well that sport, the amusements in the theater, and politics were among the most frequent topics of conversation for the people of the city, including the members of the Christian community. In fact, he pays some attention to the critical situation of the empire in the first half of the third century. In the first homily on Psalm 36, he betrays a keen perception of the weakness of the imperial power and its ephemeral character. This passage, which in the Latin translation by Rufinus has attracted much speculation on the exact chronology indicated by the preacher, does not specify a series of sovereigns, but simply points in colloquial form to those emperors who have reigned 30 years before us and were celebrated, though their glory vanished like a flower. Origen might refer here either to Septimius Severus or to one of the emperors who followed him. However, from the political point of view, the period of Caesarea is framed at the beginning and at the end by the two persecutions of Maximinus Thrax, 235, and Decius, 249-50, the latter ultimately forcing the vexed Alexandrian to relocate in Tyre, his date place. Yet, for most of the time, Origen apparently enjoyed a state of relative tranquility, so that the memories of martyrdom in his sermons often radiate a nostalgic aura and even a yearning for the previous trials and past ardor of the Christian community. Leading roles of Christians in the civic or the imperial administration, and more generally in society, thanks to their wealth, first under the Severans and later under Philip the Arab, were perhaps not so exceptional if Origen in the 12th homily on Jeremiah reprimands those faithful who boast of their position and even of their power over life and death. The favorable premises for a stay in Caesarea in a political and cultural perspective are best exemplified by the role played in this period by Julius Africanus, a colleague and friend of Palestinian origin who shared some of Origen's interests. His rich curriculum and varied literary profile distinguish him as an eminent intellectual figure during the Severan dynasty. Born most probably in Aelia Capitolina, he worked for the imperial administration on several occasions and traveled far and wide in the Mediterranean and the Near East, going from Palestine to Edessa, Rome, and Alexandria. We do not know when and where Origen made his acquaintance with him. At all events, Africanus was in touch with the Alexandrian Didaskaleion since he went to visit Heraclius. So the fragments of his two main works, the Miscellaneus Chestoi and the Chronographiae, exhibit an erudite curiosity and versatility that do not resemble very much the more typical atmosphere of Origen's studies. Africanus was also an excellent biblical scholar, as shown by his discussion of the gospel genealogies in the letter to Aristides, as well as by his letter addressed to Origen on the story of Susanna. Africanus' critique of the Alexandrian, because in a discussion with an ignorant, he had assumed it to be authentic, instead of recognizing the forgery, betrays a climate of scholarly investigation and debate in which both authors were involved, together with other learned people, Christians and Jews. Interestingly, Africanus addresses his final greetings not only to Origen, but also to the community around him. He speaks of a synodia. In his turn, the Alexandrian sends to Africanus regards from his sponsor, his lord and holy friend Ambrosius, together with his wife Marcella, their sons, and another person called Aniset, while he begs him to extend them also to our good Papa Apollinarius. We would like to know more about these two companies, but we have at least clear evidence of groups, if not of schools or communities, which devoted themselves, as it seems, to the study of Scripture as their main focus. The presence of a papas in the circle of Africanus not only invites to appreciate the nature of his Christianity more positively within an ecclesiastical horizon, but it also reminds one the other occasions of debate in which Origen was surrounded by bishops, including his preaching activity. We are thus allowed to reject the false impression that the Alexandrian would feel somehow isolated in the absence of equally minded partners in his new location. It is true that the epistolary exchange does not necessarily point to Palestine as its place, inasmuch as Origen answered Africanus from Nicomedia during a short trip there. Nevertheless, the Alexandrian insists on his long-standing sojourn in the land of Israel, and particularly on his contacts with Jewish scholars, also in order to solve the problems raised by Africanus, so that it is permitted to take this as a testimony reflecting the intellectual atmosphere that surrounded him in Palestine. Moreover, in view of the network suggested by the letter to Africanus, as well as by the scriptural occupation implied by the debate, one is led to question the simplistic identification of Origen as the Christian version of a sophist similar to the contemporary sophist described by Philostratus. We come closer to recognize the distinctive profile of the Alexandrian during his Caesarean epoch, as long as we are able to join him the church and the school, the two stages on which he acted not so much as a histrionic speaker, but rather as a preacher and a teacher. Certainly, in his preaching activity, the two roles merged in that of a priestly didaskalos. We cannot establish precisely at what time Origen started to preach, so we know that Bishop Theoctistus and Alexander of Jerusalem invited him to do so already around 215 CE, on his first visit to the country, although he was still a layman. Eusebius then tells us that Origen authorized the transcription of his sermons only when he was 60 years old, that is, around 245 CE, because until then he was not yet sure to have gained a sufficient ability. In spite of the possibly late transcription of the homilies, their long list in Jerome's letter 33 to Paula proves the frequency of Origen's preaching, which was not limited to Caesarea, but occasionally reached Jerusalem and other churches. Notens' reconstruction of a three-year cycle for the preaching on the Bible, which was meanwhile subject to doubt, is not any more acceptable in light of the new homilies on the Psalms. They prove that Origen continued to preach even after he wrote such late works as his commentary on the 12 prophets and the Against Celsus. One gets the impression that the homiletic activity became more and more important for him, as implicitly hinted at by the allegedly delayed transcription of the sermons, also when compared with his other writings. For instance, in the 32nd book of the Commentary on John, the last preserved, Origen does not refrain from quoting his homilies on Luke. The commentary on the song goes even further in referring to the homilies for a more circumstantial treatment of some passages, unless these self-quotations are added by Rufinus. Finally, when one reads the long series of the nine homilies on Psalm 77, being among the ultimate sermons that Origen delivered, one wonders what could still be the assumed distinction between commentaries and homilies. If the homiletic activity democratizes, so to speak, Origen's more elitist occupation with biblical exegesis in his school to the advantage of the Christian community, by extending his public from the disciples more generally to the faithful, both the sympathizers and the non-sympathizers, he nevertheless continues his ongoing teaching activities. Again, we do not know precisely what the school in Caesarea was compared with that in Alexandria, although we possess a unique document about it, the discourse of thanksgiving pronounced by one of his pupils as a farewell to the master. Yet it is a source not devoid of problems, starting with a question concerning its odor. Despite the charming atmosphere evoked by its picture, it is disappointing to find there but a scanty reflection of what must have been the main scholarly activity of the Alexandrian, his work on the Bible, at least in view of his extant writings with their school outlook, as for instance the commentary on Matthew. Surprisingly, no mention is made of the great enterprise of the Hexapla, while the Palestinian environment proved particularly favorable to its completion. Already in his first stay under Emperor Caracalla, Origen went hunting for manuscripts of the Greek Bible and discovered at Jericho, in a jar, another translation of the Psalms that he implemented as an additional column for the enlarged hexapla of this biblical book. Even more important was the search conducted by Origen in Caesarea on the Hebrew Bible. Leaving aside now the disputable idea that he added the two columns with the Hebrew text and its transliteration only after he settled in Palestine, he himself testifies how much he struggled over the Hebrew manuscripts in the letter to Africanus, as well as in the first homily on Psalm 77. As expressly declared by this sermon, it was a work that accompanied him until his last years, either to complete the synopsis of the Greek Old Testament or eventually to produce a distinct exemplaric text of the Septuagint on that basis. Probably the image of Origen's school in the discourse of thanksgiving essentially depends upon the apologetic agenda of its author. Being an exponent of the culture of the second sophistics, he is interested in philosophical discourse more than in the Bible itself, also because of his efforts for presenting to the Greco-Roman elite an acceptable version of Christianity. It is indeed a document that points to the larger cultural resonance of the Alexandrian and to his unique charisma as a teacher capable of reaching an audience not exclusively Christian. The anecdote on the young Porphyry listening to the lessons of Origen might confirm this impression, at least if we are allowed to situate it in Caesarea. In any case, the author of the discourse of thanksgiving, in spite of his predominantly philosophical concerns, does not wholly conceal the place of the Bible in the school as the matter of theology at its final level, whereby he shows himself aware of the scriptural hermeneutics typical of the Alexandrian. As for Origen himself, in the letter to Gregory, a younger disciple who was about to leave for Egypt to complete his education, he is very cautious with regard to the study of philosophy. Apparently, conforming with such reservations, Origen clearly differentiates his own profile as a teacher, didaskalos, inspired by the model of the Logos of God, from the way of teaching of grammarians and philosophers. In the homily on Psalm 74, he contrasts both professions with the perennial instruction assured by the Logos. Whereas the Logos imparts his teaching for eternity, a grammarian after a while has nothing new to teach, and the philosopher only condemns himself to repeat the traditional doctrines of his school. Ultimately, it is reasonable to presume that Origen's school at Caesarea stood in some continuity with that of Alexandria. Eusebius' report of the organization of the Alexandrian didaskaleion in two levels might finally correspond to the cursus studiorum described in the discourse of thanksgiving, the encluclios paideia essentially serving here, as in the letter to Gregory, as an ensemble of auxiliary disciplines for the study of the Bible. However, what the discourse ignores is, on the one hand, the new ecclesiastical context of Origen's teaching in Caesarea, in addition to his activity as preacher, and on the other hand, his interaction with Jewish rabbis and their schools. And now I come to this point, a gift of Caesarea, Origen, the rabbis and their schools. The perspective of the school inspires the transition to another major subject connected with Origen's move to Caesarea and its effects, his relations with Judaism, the rabbis and their schools. This argument has often been invoked to support the view of a substantial change, if not a more or less revolutionary modification in the Alexandrians' agenda and outlook. Now, the Jewish environment of Caesarea in Palestine obviously contributed to Origen's new familiarity with contemporary Judaism and its sages. But it would be mistaken to ignore that already in Alexandria he was confronted with Judaism and its exegetical traditions, so first and foremost by way of Philo and Hellenistic Judaism. Besides, we generally do not pay much attention to the fact that among his early writings, there is a commentary on Lamentations. The extant fragments of his work in five books prove that Origen was concerned since then about the catastrophe of Jerusalem's destruction and the fate of the Jewish people. So he elaborates on an allegorical interpretation of the tragic events by referring them either to the soul or to the church, he nonetheless seems to interact with Jewish exegetical traditions on the destruction of the temple. Maybe the choice to comment on this book of the Old Testament goes back to the influence of the Hebrew, or Hebraios, a Jewish Christian master whose importance for Origen's approach to the Bible cannot be underestimated. Several reminiscences of his teaching, significantly presented as traditions, paradoses, a term expressing for the Alexandrian an interpretive authority, accompanied him from Alexandria to Caesarea. In particular, he seems to rely on him for his typological and allegorical interpretation, not without some echoes of rabbinic exegesis. However, during the Alexandrian period, apart from the Christian master of Jewish origin and the Judeo-Christian group to which he may have belonged, we have no evidence of direct contacts with Judaism and Jewish sages. Things really changed in this respect when Origen settled in Palestine and faced directly a Jewish community at a moment in which rabbinic academies were beginning to flourish in Caesarea, as in Galilee, thanks to influential masters such as Rabbi Hoshaya Rabbah and others. We possess indeed several traces of a significant interaction with rabbis on the part of Origen, but the scholarly debate concerning the importance and width of these contacts is far from a consensual assessment. While the discussion continues to give rise to speculative hypotheses, it normally does not help to understand more precisely in what terms Origen envisaged the other things by the different linguistic, cultural, and institutional horizons of the rabbinic academies over against Origen's school, dominated by the personality of the master and by the use of books and their production. Furthermore, leaving aside the fact that Origen apparently ignores the ongoing work in rabbinic schools on the Mishnah, we may still have doubts about the extent of the affinities between the Midrashic interpretation of the rabbis and the homiletics of the Alexandrian. Having said that, we observe that Origen did occasionally engage in conversations with Jewish sages, both for his personal instruction in biblical matters and for the polemical purposes of the controversy between Christians and Jews. We hear from him, for instance, that he consulted the so-called patriarch Iullos, presumably a mistaken indication for the brother of patriarch Yehuda II, for his expertise on the psalms without title and the number of the psalms of Moses. In this circumstance, the exchange with the Jewish interlocutor mirrors a scholarly interest shared by both partners rather than polemical concerns. Origen's correct numbering of the Psalms of Moses was even approved by another sage, whom somebody would like to identify as Rabbi Hoshaya. On another occasion, recalled in the first book of the Against Celsus, we witness a public dispute with one sage in the presence of people who acted as judges of the debate. Its object was a comparison between Moses and Jesus, whereby the Alexandrian contested the lack of faith in the latter among the Jews to the exclusive privilege of the former. Other mentions of disputes, the Alexeis or Zeteseis with Jewish sages, seem likewise to imply the context of public debates in a place accessible to a larger interreligious audience. Such disputes might have taken place in the Odeon, but we should not exclude more informal meetings. As shown by a discussion on the interpretation of the suffering servants in Isaiah 52, these dialectical confrontations allowed for the expression of the respective opinions. In this case, Origen opposed his Christological interpretation of the prophetic passage to the identification with the Jewish people and its dispersion among the nations for missionary purposes. As stated by the letter to Africanus, the collation of the Greek versions of the Bible over against its Hebrew text, for which the Alexandrian created the hexapla, enabled Origen to overcome the mocking reactions of the Jews towards Gentile Christian when they relied on a Greek text different from the Hebrew. In spite of the apologetic intent that may have dictated the creation of the biblical synopsis, the inner Christian debate with Africanus proves that Origen had no scruples in consulting quite a few Jewish sages on the story of Susanna, in particular one who was called son of a sage and was educated to succeed his father. Perhaps also the consultation of the Hebrew manuscripts took place through personal contacts with rabbis rather than by the way of public institutes like archives or libraries, or with the supposed assistance of Jewish collaborators. It is altogether a kind of work that seems to rest on a knowledge of Hebrew less rudimentary than is normally supposed in Origen, as long as he refers to Hebrew antigrapha exemplars and not to the second column of the hexapla with a transliterated Hebrew text. On the other hand, it has been supposed that even Jews used Origen's synopsis, for example, to revise the Septuagint text of Philonic manuscripts, or, more probably, Philo's use by the Alexandrian did not escape the attention of the rabbis. As a result of these contacts, which ought to be considered within the larger framework of the dialogues and disputations going on among Christians, both Orthodox and Heterodox, or between Christians, Jews, and pagans, Origen has become, in the eyes of some scholars, as it were, a mediator of rabbinic traditions. Accordingly, he is seen as a source, probably not yet fully exploited, for retracing the transmission of Agadic materials attested in a later period by rabbinic literature. Among the alleged similarities, the Alexandrian seems in particular to display affinities with the contemporary figure like Rabbi Yohanan bar Napa, a former pupil of Rabbi Hoshaya and a teacher at Tiberias, in regard to the exegesis of the Song of Songs. The two scholars might have been aware of each other, while Rabbi Yochanan would react against Origen's Christologization of the song's allegory. Other interpretive influences in both directions are likely to be detected with regard to the interpretation of the Pentateuch and other biblical books, especially the Psalms and the Prophets. However, depending on the comparative materials at hand, we also meet in the scholarship more reserved, if not skeptical, evaluations, according to which the existence of parallels between Origen and the rabbis does not necessarily demand a direct dialogue among them for their explanation. Nor is it possible to exclude the interference with the Judeo-Christian milieu pointed to by the Alexandrians' relations with the Jewish Christian master. Judging from Origen's polemical concerns about Ebionism and Judaizing Christians in his preaching at Caesarea, we may even infer that there were in Palestine Judeo-Christian masters and eventually schools promoting their version of Christianity for the Gentiles. In spite of some incertitudes, the final impression we get about Origen's contacts with the rabbis is, after all, that Caesarea and the land of Israel made him, through them, so to say, a unique gift for developing his biblical interpretation. In fact, for no other author of Christian antiquity do we possess evidence of an analogous familiarity with Jewish sages and their exegetical traditions. This does not otherwise imply that Origen substantially modified his theological approach to Judaism, as the rabbis, in their turn, did not either with regard to Christianity. Conforming with the views generally shared by the Church Fathers, in principle, the Alexandrian likewise supports a supersessionist vision. Moreover, having come to stay in Palestine, he added to the recurrent motifs of his anti-Judaism, essentially based on the antithesis between the literal and the spiritual interpretation of the Old Testament, with the subsequent rejection of the Jewish ritual observances, the impossibility to celebrate the Jewish festivals in Jerusalem, a city no longer inhabited by the Jews. As suggested by the 17th homily on Joshua, Origen probably witnessed the mourning of the Jews facing the ruined city. In this sermon, instead of insisting on a polemical note, he invites them to turn their face from earthly Jerusalem, a city destroyed and reduced to ashes and dust, and direct their gaze towards the heavenly Jerusalem, which is the mother of all. All that notwithstanding, the hint to an important motive derived from Paul, Galatians 4:26, can help us to regard more positively Origen's relations with Judaism, last not least also as a result of his stay in Caesarea and the land of Israel. Not only is the apostle for him the authority on the issue of Judaism, especially with the 11th chapter of the letter to the Romans, on which the Alexandrian commented during his Palestinian period. He also unveils in several writings a thought that is not less concerned about the fate of the Jews and their salvation. I refer here to the interpretation of Jesus' prayer in Gethsemane, given by Origen in the Exhortation to Martyrdom, the Against Celsus, and the Commentary on Matthew. One of the explanations to Jesus' demand for the passing of the cup points to his desire of assuring a more universal kind of redemption through his death. If the exhortation thus alludes to the Jews only implicitly, the reference to them becomes explicit in the Against Celsus and the Commentary on Matthew. Jesus prays to the Father that the catastrophe of the Jewish people and the destruction of Jerusalem be avoided. This interpretation did not yet figure in the writings of the Alexandrian period, so it appears that Origen contemplated it thanks to his new Palestinian milieu. By way of a conclusion, fortune and misfortune of Origen's legacy in the Holy Land. So far, I try to illustrate in what way Caesarea and Palestine may have impressed new directions on Origen's work and thought. As a consequence of this period, to be regarded as particularly fruitful for the Alexandrian, he bequeathed to the incoming Holy Land of the Christians, of which he was, in a sense, a forerunner, a rich literary and theological legacy. By way of a conclusion, I shall deal very briefly with his legacy, merely to stress again for further research the decisiveness of the Palestinian setting with its vicissitudes, fortunate and unfortunate. In fact, the echoes of the great Alexandrian resounded in Christian Palestine more or less directly until the end of the Byzantine period, not least because of the intermittent crisis that his doctrines generated. Yet, first of all, we have to do with a literary heritage, consisting not simply of Origen's writings, but also of the authors of the Judeo-Hellenistic and Christian tradition of Alexandria, primarily Philo, together with works of Greek philosophers and historians, which he carried with him coming to Caesarea. With his own books, the Alexandrian created the premises for the Christian library of Caesarea, the most important one at the beginning of Christianity. It was the merit of Pamphilus if Origen's personal library was not dispersed after his death. Thanks to the work as librarian and copyist by Pamphilus himself and his disciple Eusebius, an exceptionally learned scholar, the most precious stock of the library was further enriched with other texts. Later on, the Bishop of Caesarea took care of the library, as we hear from Jerome, who recalls the restoration work undertaken by Acacius and Eusoius, with a transcription of the volumes from rolls into codices. Generally, the history of the tradition of Origen's writings needs to be investigated more thoroughly than it was in the past, also as far as the Holy Land is concerned. It goes without saying that the process of transmission originated in the collection at the Library of Caesarea. In spite of some losses already attested by Eusebius from the start, due to the difficulty of putting together the remains of such a huge corpus, Caesarea was the place where the works of the Alexandrian were preserved and transmitted to posterity. At the end of the 4th and the beginning of the 5th centuries, both Jerome and Rufinus witnessed the persistence of his heritage and its accessibility, the hexapla included. Subsequently, we are able to follow the traces of the reading of Origen in Christian Palestine until the eve of the Arab conquest. In the first half of the 6th century, the monks in the Cenobium of Cerridus near Gaza have in their hands works that were later lost for us as the commentary on Titus. More important is the fact that the compilers of Catenae, like Procopius of Gaza or the monastic milieu responsible for the so-called Palestinian Catena on the Psalms, still largely drew from the extant commentaries and homilies of Origen. Further study of the rich theological and spiritual literature of the 6th and 7th centuries will perhaps convey new evidence for an acquaintance with the writings of the Alexandrian, despite the change in theological discourse, with the emergence of a scholastic theology and the disappearance of a creative exegesis, apart from a few exceptions. We could ask then whether this literary heritage, which for a while was widely read, assured, first of all, continuity to Origen's school of Caesarea, while promoting exegetical and theological interests of a corresponding nature. With regard to that, we may notice a shift of emphasis, already starting with the school of Pamphilus. The picture that we have, through Eusebius' description of the life of the martyr and the circle of his disciples, juxtaposes, as it were, the scriptorium to the school and confers to the latter a decidedly more philological profile, so putting it once more at the service of the Bible as it was for Origen. Some manuscripts witness the admirable philological work that Pamphilus and Eusebius were able to conduct together with other members of the school, thus continuing the Alexandrian's work on the Hexapla. This philological task apparently provided the scholarly frame for an exegetical activity in what remained of the previous school. Both Eusebius and his successor Acacius seem to have pursued it in conformity with Origen's thetetic method, when we consider, for instance, Eusebius' questions and answers on the Gospels, or Acacius' miscellaneous questions. Moreover, Origen's philological ascendancy plays an essential part as a model for Jerome's remarkable accomplishment as translator and interpreter of the scriptures for Western Christianity. In some respect, Jerome even appears to be more faithful to Origen than Eusebius himself, who otherwise is not primarily an exegete anymore, whereas we can speak of the monk of Bethlehem, at least from the exegetical point of view, not only as a mediator, but as a true imitator of the Alexandrian, as shown by his large reuse and adaptation of Origenian materials in commentaries and homilies. Eusebius distinguishes himself thanks to a hermeneutical approach more attentive to the literal and historical meanings of the scriptures. As such, the Bishop of Caesarea, in spite of his declared originist affiliation, anticipates affinities with the Antiochene school of exegesis. However, it was Eusebius who firmly placed Origen within the context of the early church, by largely devoting to him the sixth book of the ecclesiastical history. Besides, together with Pamphilus, he assured the defense of the exegetical and doctrinal heritage of Origen when he was attacked by Methodius of Olympus and others towards the end of the third century. The apology by Pamphilus and Eusebius, together with the later Philokalia, is a major document for examining the changing perception of Origen in the course of the dogmatic conflicts between the 4th and the 6th centuries. Its positive appreciation of the searching attitude developed by the Alexandrian will find only a pale reflection in later period, as shown by the correspondence of Barsanuphius and John of Gaza, where the claim for a similar approach is now put under the authority of Gregory of Nazianzus. For a while, the Church of Palestine seems to have been influenced by Origen and his thought, as shown by Himenaeus of Jerusalem in the process of Paul of Samosata, or even by John of Jerusalem around the turn of the 5th century when the first Origenist crisis broke out. John, together with Rufinus and Melania the Elder, opposed the condemnation of Origen by Epiphanius of Salamis in the wake of his preaching at the Anastasis, supported by Jerome and Theophilus of Alexandria. Reminiscences of Origen might be retraced in Hesychius of Jerusalem, the most important exegete of Palestine after Eusebius and a sympathizer of the Alexandrian theology, whose office as a teacher of the church, didaskalos tes ecclesias, of the holy city, might still reverberate an Originian imprint. However, both the first and the second Originist crisis concur to undermine the doctrinal authority of the Alexandrian. The second of these controversies finally led to the condemnation of Origen, together with Evagrius and Didymus the Blind, on the occasion of the Second Ecumenical Council of Constantinople in 553. As shown by the two names joined to Origen, the new crisis had a major difference compared with the preceding one, which determined a struggle between Jerusalem and Bethlehem. In the 6th century, the focus of dispute was not anymore the classical Origenism, with the most controversial doctrines of the Alexandrian, but its creative reshaping by Evagrius for a monastic audience in Egypt. The spread of Evagrianism reached Palestine, becoming here particularly alive, especially in the monasteries of the Judean desert. Our picture of the conflict is essentially determined by hostile witnesses, such as Cyril of Scythopolis, but we can reasonably presume that some of Origen's writings join those of Evagrius. Unfortunately, the adversaries of the Origenist monks, who relied on the confutation of the apology of Pamphilus and Eusebius by Antipater of Bostra in the 5th century, won Emperor Justinian for their cause. Thus, in the end, the remarkable fortune enjoyed by Origen in the Holy Land turned into a misfortune lasting for centuries in the Byzantine world and beyond it in Eastern as well as in Western Christianity. Happily, to compensate in advance for the losses that largely derived from the condemnation of 553 for the Greek origin in Byzantium and the Christian East, Westerners like Jerome and Rufinus, overcoming in different ways their doctrinal hesitations after the dogmatic developments since Nicaea, partially contributed to the survival of Origen's literary heritage, last but not least, thanks precisely to the familiarity that they had gained with his works in the Holy Land. To conclude in a good Originian manner, let us go back from the end to the beginning. In his Panarion, Epiphanius of Salamis has a different story about Origen and Jerusalem. Once the Alexandrian, asked by the church authorities to preach, chose to read only one verse of Psalm 49, skipping over the rest. But to the sinner, God said, "Why do you recite my statutes and take my covenant on your lips?" After that, he closed the book, gave it back, and sat crying. With this malevolent anecdote, Origen's archenemy unwillingly pays him homage in line with the monastic spirituality of his own time, by presenting the Alexandrian in the mood of a repenting sinner. It is a proof, among many others, of the appeal that Origen has always exerted, even for his adversaries, while providing indirectly a case for hope to all those who are the object of rejection and exclusion. Of course, there is no need nowadays to rehabilitate Origen in front of Epiphanius and his other accusers. At all events, whether we believe or not in the providential course of history, as I do, still hoping against hope, during the next few days we shall hear again the voice of Origen in Jerusalem, through so many contributions turning around him and his legacy to the Holy Land. If I may add a personal impression, this legacy is more than ever a living heritage, since it points to a spiritual horizon worthy of the religious traditions of this holy city of Jerusalem, which is indeed the mother of us all, also as the historical anticipation of the Heavenly One. Thus, the fact of being assembled in Jerusalem in the shade of Origen is not the least merit for which I would like to thank most warmly Chavera Sheli, Bruria Bitton Ashkeloni, and all the Israeli colleagues who have organized this marvelous conference. Toda.
Thank you so much, Professor Peroni. Thank you so much, Toda Rabba, for this erudite and very interesting lecture. Normally in this kind of lectures we don't have a discussion, but we have 3 days to discuss this lecture with Professor Peroni. So thanks for coming to celebrate the opening session with us. Good evening.